Echo and Harper Audio present Cuba on the Verge. 12 Writers on Continuity and Change in Havana and Across the Country. By Leila Guerriero. Performed by Lorenzo Irizarry and Frankie Corzo.
Introduction. 12 Attempts. Of all the questions that journalism must ask, who, what, where, when, why, and how, there's only one that can be answered easily when we talk about Cuba. Where? Everyone more or less knows where Cuba is. When it comes to the rest of the questions, what is Cuba? Who are the Cubans? What is Cuba like? When did Cuba start being what it is? Why is Cuba the way it is? And the different variations and combinations of those questions. Not only are there no easy answers, but everyone seems to have their own. For some, Fidel Castro is a wise and admirable hero, but for others, he is a tyrant who led a dictatorship for decades. For some, Cuba is a paradise made of palm trees, sun, and sea, with education and healthcare for all. While for others, it's a country constantly suffering from shortages, filled with unbelievably smart biologists and architects working as taxi drivers. For some, Cuba is a model of equality and justice. But for others, it is a place that sneakily replicates the blights of the West: corruption, the class system, social inequality. For some, it's a fantasy island. For others, it's a prison. The 12 essays that make up this book try to distance themselves from these oversimplifications and, in telling us about this country, cover terrain that is much more dangerous and also more interesting: that of doubt and contradiction. The journalists and writers who have participated in this volume, non-Cubans living in Cuba, Cubans who live in Cuba, Cubans who have left Cuba, non-Cubans who have visited Cuba, are writing about a country whose population has been educated in the most fervent atheism, but also avidly drinks from the cup of African religions. A country for which the United States is an overbearing nemesis, but which also carries baseball, the American sport par excellence, deep in its DNA. A country where women are queens and mistresses of their bodies. Getting a curettage, abortion, done in Cuba is much more common than going to the dentist, writes Wendy Guerra. But where none hold a position of power, not even as the wives of its leaders. An abyss lies between Fidel and a naked woman, Guerra writes. The current president of Cuba, Raúl Castro, is the widower of Vilma Espín, also a revolutionary fighter. He is said to be a family man, but no one knows anything about his life today. As for the female figure's relationship to Cuban heroes, leaders, and rulers, she isn't even in the background. She simply doesn't exist. Leonardo Padura writes an ode to baseball, lamenting the advance of soccer over the sport that he once wanted to play professionally, and asks what will happen to the Cuban identity in the face of this and other changes. The actor, Vladimir Cruz, remembers how in 1993, in the most difficult moment of the special period, he arrived in Havana as a 27-year-old with 200 Cuban pesos in his pocket. I had wanted to make it to the capital with my feet on the ground, and in effect, there I was. But instead of my feet, I had my back on the ground in the capital, on the floor of the capital's bus terminal, that is. I slept a bit and opened my eyes at daybreak when the terminal opened. I got up, washed my face with a tiny trickle of water that dripped into the sink of the dilapidated and fetid bathroom. That morning, he won a breakout role in the movie Strawberry and Chocolate, and though he was able to pursue his vocation in large part because of enormous support from the state, it was that same state that, with whimsical arbitrariness, prevented him from doing things such as attending the Oscar ceremony in 1994, when the movie was nominated for Best Foreign Film. Abraham Jimenez Enoa paints a vivid portrait of Ernesto, a jinetero, a man whose principal tool in his work is sex with foreign women. Carlos Manuel Alvarez makes clear that emigrating, more than just leaving, means ripping a country from one's body, as he recounts his 2015 visit to his father, who had recently emigrated to Miami, a man who in Cuba had been a doctor and who now works knocking coconuts from trees in the gardens of luxurious homes belonging to others. Iván de la Nuez wonders where Cuba is headed after Obama and the Pope and the Rolling Stones and the fashionable cafes and the Havana streets transformed for the set of The Fate of the Furious, and what road he traveled to arrive here. An American, Francisco Goldman, returned to the stage he visited decades earlier, the Tropicana, the capital's most iconic nightclub, and follows in the footsteps of a glorious past that no longer exists, or exists only in part, or exists in a different way. The Spaniard, Mauricio Vicente, explores the history of the bolita, an illegal lottery brought to Cuba by the Chinese, in which numbers are associated with certain animals, people, or things, unveiling a sophisticated system of bets that brings together magic, poetry, the interpretation of dreams, and, of course, ambition. On one of his first visits to Havana, the Mexican Rubén Gallo got to know Eliezer. The bookseller whose story he tells, and in which converge different forms of sensuality, the tricks used to cheat the censors, and his expectations for the immediate future. In Mi Amigo Manuel, Patricia Engel, a Colombian-American living in the United States, tells us about the driver of an almendrón, the name for the classic American cars from the 50s that are sometimes turned into taxis. A man who seems to have crossed the threshold into all kinds of resignation. He works 15 hours a day. He only rests on Sundays. And he says he would never leave Cuba, not for love of country, but because he doesn't want to abandon his mother. The American journalist, John Lee Anderson, recalls his experience living in Cuba with his family during the special period, as he conducted research for his biography of Che Guevara, and notes the contradiction between the hardships of the locals, forced to live with very little, and his privileged position as a foreigner. The Chilean, Patricio Fernandez, using the background of a grim yet luminous cockfight, writes about the tensions that have rippled through the turbulent ocean of the revolution. The revolution's great conquest was of time. Cubans are not in a hurry. The time agreed on for an appointment is only an approximate reference. Since public transportation is unpredictable, delay is easy to understand. What's more, little is lost by waiting. People who work assiduously are rare, since the salary fixed by the state is around $30 a month. Chatting on the corner is almost as profitable as exerting yourself in a profession. More is obtained por la izquierda, or to the left, commissions, bribes, and all kinds of kickbacks that function at the edges of institutionality, than by obediently exercising a trade. When it came time to produce, the community's well-being turned out to be a much less convincing motivator than personal benefit. Efficiency disappeared the moment profit was forbidden, and with it, haste. If capitalism's success has led to a growing self-sufficiency, socialism's failure consolidated the need to rely on others in order to survive. To retell the history of Cuba, like recounting the invasion of Normandy or the fall of the Berlin Wall, is to recount history with a capital H, an ambitious job. Here are 12 attempts. Leila Guerriero.
Inside. Miami, the Coconut Trail, by Carlos Manuel Alvarez. Translated by Anna Kushner. Copyright 2017 by Carlos Manuel Alvarez. At the end of May 2015, I landed in Miami from Havana. I must have been one of the few Cubans who had ever set foot in that city, not to migrate definitively, but only to visit. My plan was to spend 2 months with my father, Manolo, who had arrived a year and a half before to rebuild his life from nothing. In the airport, I walked down cold hallways, crossed through glass waiting rooms and customs inspection stations. I was afraid. I realized later that it was a fear that didn't belong to me, because I didn't have any reason to be afraid. But there it was. It was the fear inside of all of us. They asked me questions, nothing out of the ordinary. They looked at my beard, I think, my funny year-old beard. When I got out, my father was waiting for me. He and I cried our respective melodramatic tears. Later, on an expressway headed toward the city, I asked myself if those tears hadn't been an exaggeration. At the end of the day, it had only been a little over a year since I had last seen him. Other people never saw each other again or met again 3 decades later, when they were already something else, just shadows, broken without possible repair. On the way, I saw so many signs that I didn't see any of them. I saw the face of Magic Johnson on the door of a bus. I saw the faces of lawyers on ads. I wondered what someone on an ad thinks when he sees his own ad. In a store, my father bought me some candy. He said he knew that I liked it. We weren't surprised, after the first few hours, by the ease with which we had linked that last day in Cuba to the first one here in Miami. We were surprised by the reunion. How smooth it was, how light, how little it weighed. Sometimes one doesn't leave to go outside, but to go inside. "What do you do now?" I asked René Arocha. "I'm a driver for a medical clinic for the elderly. I take them to appointments and then take them back to their houses." "When did you separate yourself completely from baseball?"
5 years ago. And since then, I've worked at this."
"Are you still passionate about baseball?"
"No."
"No?"
"No."
"Explain that to me." "Everyone asks me if I saw the Marlins game. If I saw this, if I saw that. I don't watch ball. It's like when you stop liking a woman. I don't feel anything anymore. Before, I needed it. I dreamed of baseball. I lived baseball. Not anymore."
"Couldn't it be that you still like the woman, and since she doesn't want to be with you anymore, you reject her out of spite?"
"No, no. Since I was little, 10 or 11 years old, my grandfather would tell me to sit down and watch some games so I could learn. And I never did. Perhaps this is a regression. I stopped playing and now I'm not interested. Sometimes I see a game, I don't know, the last one of the World Series, something like that, but nothing else."
"Do you watch other sports?"
"No, nothing."
"What is baseball to you?"
"Being on the field, especially in the mornings when you go out to practice, smelling the grass. You can really feel that fresh grass."
My father lived at 418 East 60th Street in Ialea, Miami's Cuban neighborhood, in a studio so small that once inside, there was no spot from which I could not see him, nor he me. Bed, closet, bathroom, and kitchen in a proximity that did not allow for distinctions. The spaces were less the fruit of architecture than of our imaginations. I slept on an air mattress at the foot of his bed, just below the grill that blew cold air from the ceiling. My former asthma came back. My coughing and expectorating kept us from sleeping. My father had to wake up at 6 every morning to distribute and fix air conditioners until well into the afternoon. He had a job at an old friend's refrigeration business that didn't pay much, about $400 a week, and then at night he went to school to learn English. Sometimes, back home, with his elbows propped on a small table, he would listen to several tracks to practice his pronunciation or fine-tune his ear, or he would look something up on Google, typing with just 2 fingers as if he were a diligent typist transmitting life-or-death messages from deepest Africa. Each time my father typed a letter, he looked at the screen to verify that the letter showed up. It took an insane amount of time for him to complete a word. He embodied these old ways of doing things that would have otherwise been lost. He was like a time capsule, preserving certain gestures, the medieval slowness of copiers, and keeping them uncorrupted by new habits. With his dusty soul.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.